Mike Dell's World number 398. And today is the 22nd of February 2024. Happy New Year, since I didn't talk. I haven't talked to you since November. Well, or maybe December. I don't know. Anyway, all is well here in Northern Michigan. And today I want to talk about a particular subject, but I figured I'd catch you up on all the personal details. I had my shoulder surgery in October, which, if you listen to any of the Napod Pomo episodes, I was in the midst of recovering. Well, I'd say 90% recovered, back to flying. So I've been doing quite a bit of flying here lately. So it's been fun. And I got all that, got all the shoulder pain taken care of. It's still a little stiff. Don't quite have the range of motion that I have had in the past. By the way, I don't have any fancy sound effects today because I'm using a different USB interface. My Rodecaster keeps failing me, and I think it's more the computer than the Rodecaster. So I'm using a Foresight Solo. What it's called. So if it sounds it shouldn't sound any different. I've got the same setup otherwise, but anyway, that's why I'm not gonna play the intro music and all that stuff, because I don't like to edit if I don't have to. And speaking of podcasting, of course, you guys might know that I started another podcast with Mike Wilkerson. So I have a partner in crime, and we're doing it slow. So we're starting out with a couple episodes a month, but they're going to be coming out in video podcast, audio podcast, and YouTube, a YouTube channel, a proper YouTube channel, not a fake video YouTube channel like you could find this show on. If you go to YouTube Music, I'm now on YouTube Music with this one, and also there's a YouTube channel, but basically it's just this audio with the artwork as a still shot. So it's kind of lame, in my humble opinion. You're better off going to podcastapps.com and pick one of those apps. Lately I've been using Castomatic. And it has a lot of neat features. Not all the features, but a lot of neat ones from Podcasting 2.0. Another good one is, of course, Podverse and Fountain. Those are pretty popular these days. And another one you might like is Podcast Guru. Nice thing about Castomatic is if you like Overcast, and I still like Overcast, but if you like Overcast, this is kind of the, it's not quite a clone, but darn close. And the nice thing I like about that is it has a thing called collections or smart playlists that work really good, for how I like to listen to podcasts. You know, I have them separated by aviation, cars, news, I have a fun category where I just throw things in there and, you know, it works out really good because it automatically puts, you know, a playlist together of those types of shows that you've downloaded to your phone. And speaking of phones, that's going to be the main subject of today's episode. I've been doing a lot of thinking about, you know, all this stuff we have in our pocket, you know, the little device that can do just about everything and anything, and there's an app for that. Well, all those apps have consequences, especially the free ones. The free apps, as I've said all along since all this technology started, if you're getting something for free, you're the product. And, you know, they love selling data and collecting data and, you know, targeting you for advertisements. And you know, I become very intolerant of advertisements. And, of course, I'm probably going to be contradicting myself in this subject because I do some things that are counterintuitive to what I'm talking about. But what I'm talking about is, you know, what's the difference, or what, you know, what would be your thought about going back to a dumb phone, or maybe not even carrying a cell phone at all? But let's just assume you need to have a cell phone so you can at least make phone calls and receive phone calls and maybe text. You know, texts kind of bother me sometimes too, when people kind of use that in replacement of regular communications. You know, it used to be you could just pick up the phone and call it, and you know, you and the other person on the other end didn't know who was calling, and that was good in some ways and obviously bad in other ways, because there's a lot of scammers and telemarketers, and anymore the telemarketers are freaking lazy. They just have a bot do it. And you know, with AI coming on and all that, no matter, you know, who knows what's going to happen with the smartphones and all that. You know, I have an iPhone 15 Pro Max, whatever, the latest greatest iPhone, and I do enjoy it. It has a wonderful camera, and but I've just found it that I'm very overconnected, I guess would be the way to put it. I you know, I'm not too worried about Google following me around and all that, but I have decided that I'm going to de-Google my existence on the internet, at least personally. Of course, you know, we use a lot of Google for work. You know, so I've got to kind of do that, but I have it kind of compartmentalized on my work computer. I have all the stuff that I need. I don't have it on my phone. And yeah, I do, you know, the only thing I have on my phone that's Google related is YouTube. And because I have YouTube, I don't have to watch commercials other than what's built into some of the YouTube channels. But so that's one contradiction there. Yes, I'm still going to be watching YouTube. Now, I've tried Rumble, and I like Rumble, but Rumble doesn't have the variety of things that I like to watch that YouTube does. But anyway, getting back to the smartphone versus dumb phone versus de-Googling and de-Facebooking and all that, I do have a Facebook. I don't particularly post to it a whole lot. I use it mainly for work. And, you know, and usually when I post something on Facebook, it's usually something I think is funny anyway. I don't know if the rest of you think that, but I try not to use Facebook as a communications platform necessarily. I do use Twitter or X. I'm more active on that, but I still don't post a heck of a lot on there either. I'm mostly lurking and reading and all that, which is actually kind of a good thing. And I don't have either of those apps on my cell phone. Now I have an iPad mini that I don't carry it around with me all that often, but when I'm home, I use that kind of my easy chair machine and I use it for flying. You know, I got my electronic flight bag on it and all the maps and, you know, that kind of stuff, but, I don't carry it around with me that much. So the location data thing isn't as big a deal as it is with a phone. Now, you know, of course, your carrier has your location all the time, and probably nothing you can do to block that, you know, except for turning the whole thing off. And even the new dumb phones are that way. I was reading an article on the BBC. And where is that? Ah, here it is. The title of it is Not Smart But Clever, The Return of Dumb Phones. And it seems to be a thing with high school age, or Gen Z, I guess you would call that, you know, I don't know, up to 20-somethings. I don't know. I don't know the generations all that well. I just know I'm a Gen X, an early Gen X. But you know, in here in the article, you know, you're talking about this this girl in high school that she just has a dumb phone, you know, Nokia 3310, which is about, I'm 24 years old now, although they do have newer versions of it. So I'm sure there's a lot of the tracking stuff. And like I said, I'm not that worried about the tracking as much. But the thing is it's so easy, you know, when you get bored, you pull out your phone and you look at something. And you pull out your phone and you look at something else. You know, you scroll or you know, we call, I call my iPad my toilet scroller. It's, you know, sitting there instead of reading the newspaper or a magazine, well, I got my iPad. So, you know, like I said, I got my foot in both worlds. But as far as my cell phone, I've dumbed it down a lot. I've taken off pretty much all of the quote-unquote fun apps. You know, I don't have any games on it. I don't have, you know, any social media on it. Basically, it's a telephone and a text device. You know, it's kind of a necessary evil. And I do have a browser on it, but I did go to the Brave browser. So instead of using the stock Safari browser on iPhone or Chrome or any of those other ones, I figured that's good enough. I took all the mapping programs off my phone with the exception of Apple Maps, because, you know, it is handy to be able to plug it into the truck and have the maps on the screen. So that's, you know, that's a compromise I'll take. And Apple seems to be better at the privacy thing than a lot of other places, but maybe not significantly so. You just never know, but they seem to be better at it. And, you know, other things I've done, I do have Face ID on my phone, so I can unlock it with my face. That's a convenience. But you think about that. If you were to get pulled over by a police officer who thinks you did something that you shouldn't have done, and they have your phone, they can't unlock it if you have Face ID turned off. You know, otherwise they can just hold it up to your face and get it to unlock. But if it has a code, of course, when you have Face ID, you still have a code. And I don't know how it works on Android. I decided that Android is not what I'm going to be doing. So I guess I could do a de-Googled Android phone if I wanted to, but I think I'll stick with Apple just because they seem to last longer and they're reasonably good at privacy. But along that line, it's just, there's so many apps tracking. So I took off all the apps. I got to the Brave browser as my only browser on the phone. So if I really want to look something up, I can. I have a couple banking apps on there that just makes it really easy. So I do that. I have the airline apps on there. Or I put them on right before a trip is what I usually do, because I don't always fly the same airline. And that works out pretty well because you just, you know, you use it and then you get rid of it. You know, just having a whole bunch of apps on your phone just makes it so you want to play with it more. And it's amazing what those devices will do. And I do see a use case for it. But, you know, I went to the restaurant with a buddy of mine. We do our Thursday night solving the world's problems session. I got back from that a little while ago. This is Thursday night when I'm recording this. And I just kind of looked around the place. We were just at a Chili's and looked around the place. And there were people, you know, couples there, you know, both looking at their phones instead of talking to each other. And, you know, I guess on one level, I think that's probably not good. But anyway, so yeah, I've dumbed down the phone a little bit. A phone that I was interested in, it's not Apple, it's not Android. I'm sure it has some form of Linux under the hood, but called the Light Phone, and it's at thelightphone.com, and it has just the basic stuff on it. It has it's a minimal phone, has an e-ink screen. It does not have social media. It does not have news. It does not have email. It does not have a browser. but it does have some of the stuff that I would like to have. It does phone calls. It does texts. Does calendar, alarm, and podcasts. I don't know how well it does podcasts. But it also has Bluetooth, so you can play your podcasts through through your Bluetooth in your car if you have that. And you can use it as a hotspot. So I was thinking, you know, geez, I have a light phone and then an iPad. And, you know, so the iPad could be the one I do all the browsing and whatnot. And I don't always have to bring that with me. But, you know, if I want to go light, I take the light phone. So I don't know. I'm thinking about that. They're a little spendy. And I haven't seen one in person. But it looks like quite the compromise between the smart and the dumb phone. And I'll have an article here that I went through. I didn't do everything in this article that they suggest, but it's how to turn your iPhone into a dumb phone. And you could do it. That's the thing. And the beauty of that is if you ever want to add an app for some reason, you know, if you're traveling or whatever, you throw it on there, you do your thing, you turn it off. You know, it's, and there's a lot of other, you know, privacy stuff. But like I said, I'm not that worried about privacy. I want to avoid ads and I want to avoid distractions. I find it's a lot nicer to take a drive and just not have to worry about the phone ringing, because I don't answer my phone when I'm driving, unless I'm on a really long trip. But if I'm just driving around town, yeah, it'll wait, leave a voicemail. Send me a text. I'll read it when I stop. Or technically the truck will read it to me, or the Siri lady in the in CarPlay. But, most of the time, that stuff's not an emergency. You know, and what did we do 20 years ago and not everybody was carrying around a phone? Or maybe 30 years ago. I don't know. Just getting old. I remember traveling cross country. I didn't have a phone. I didn't have a GPS. I had a map, or several maps. You know, I used to go between here and Idaho, at least once a year. And I'd make that entire trip with a map, a ham radio, and an AM, FM radio in the truck. I didn't even have cassettes or CDs. I mean, you know, CDs were around, but didn't have any of that in the truck. I just had AM, FM. And, that was good enough. You know, you listen to an AM station at night, you know, you could listen to it for a long time and, you know, listen to talk radio or whatever. If you want to find some music, it's all over the FM dial. The only thing is you had to change the channel every so often when you run out of the station. Wasn't really a big deal. And I wasn't going too far off the beaten trail, so it wasn't like I needed to find, you know, some place out in the middle of the mountain somewhere. So I didn't need the GPS. The GPS didn't even exist at the time. And, you know, now we're spoiled, you know, satellite radio and streaming stuff to our phones and podcasts and all that stuff. You know, I believe me, I love podcasts. I do them. I listen to them. I do all that stuff, but I don't, I don't want to be continually inundated with news, and I don't need to know all that stuff. If anything really big happens, I'll figure it out. So I'm still continuing. I'm going on 4 years here that I don't watch any of the national news. I read some of it. And another thing, you know, geez, I'm just going all over on this tech stuff. You know, like I said, I'm a geek, but man, I'm telling you, it's getting to the point where it's overwhelming. Not that I don't know what it does, and I do understand its value, but I think we're going down a path that's gonna really mess us up in the future. You know, what happened, like today, this morning, AT&T had a massive outage, almost nationwide, on their cellular network. And people were freaking out. My sister calls me, or texts me, actually, and she did it via Wi-Fi on the app. And she goes, hey, I don't have any phone service or no internet, whatever, other than their Wi-Fi at home. And, you know, she was just freaking out about it. She's like, what happened? What's going on? You know, and all that. Well, you know, my theory is that it was a couple of X-class flares that came off the sun earlier, last night, I guess. But messed something up. Who knows? They're talking maybe even cyber attacks or whatever. But, you know, people would be lost without their phones now. You know, I've made it a habit of mine to every once in a while just leave the phone at home when I go out. You know, go out, run errands, I'll leave the phone at home. I've done that a few times. Not very often, but I've done it. So, but like I said, I'm a little bit of an enigma because I still, you know, I love the tech that I love, but just everywhere is advertising and it's targeted advertising, you know, and you got these speaker boxes and, you know, I want to say her name, but, you know, the Amazon Echo device, you know, we've got them and, you know, plus your phone's listening to you. And if you have Facebook on your phone, Facebook's listening to you. I'm sure X is listening. Everybody that's selling ads and data are listening, you know, and, you know, I'm not totally against ads, but I like to avoid them as much as I can. Now, you know, podcasts that I like that have ads in them, I generally listen through the ads. If it's if it's a way they can tell that I actually listened or not, but for the most part, they can't. And I'll sometimes forward through them if I've heard the ad 200 times or something. But, you know, but if it's a podcast that I'm thinking about, you know, subscribing to or listening to on a regular basis, if they overdo the ads, I'm out of there. You know, same thing with YouTube channels. If I watch a YouTube channel and every 10 minutes the host is doing a host read endorsement for something that he's talking about on the video, probably won't watch that much anymore. You know, they get paid pretty good from YouTube for people that don't pay the whatever it is, $15 a month, or, you know, they get YouTube premium. And I do that because, again, I just don't want the ads. And I don't need to be inundated with tracking. But, you know, famously to me, I guess, there's nothing famous about this. But my wife and I, a few years ago, were talking about getting the underground fence for our dogs. Because, you know, we're like, well, you know, the fence that we have a regular fence and you know, it's good enough for most situations, but, you know, sometimes the gate gets knocked open or left open or something and they could get out. And, you know, we live on a busy road and, you know, I just don't want to be tracking down beagles. So, we were talking about that and I swear she got on her computer and her laptop, sitting in the easy chair and went to Facebook. And then immediately there were ads for underground fences and GPS dog collars and all that sort of stuff. And I mean, it was like instantaneous. So I don't know whether her phone was listening or Facebook was listening or Google was listening or the Amazon talking tube lady was listening. I don't know. But, you know, that just kind of creeped me out. And it happens a lot. And, you'd be amazed at the amount of data they have on you if you're carrying around a smartphone. And probably not avoidable completely, but you could mitigate some of it. And again, you know, back to the attention span thing, you know, I made the mistake one time of loading TikTok on a phone. And it was like a time warp. I don't think I think I was on that app for 2 hours and it felt like 10 minutes. And so they really got that algo dialed in to keep your attention. You know, same thing with Facebook. You know, you scroll down Facebook and your timeline there and there'll always be some sensational clickbaity thing. Oh, I want to check this out. And then before you know it, you've wasted a whole bunch of time for a whole bunch of nothing. And one of the things that I find also interesting that most people probably don't even know about anymore, but it used to be really popular in the early 2000s, was feed readers. So, you know, this same thing that gets you this podcast, RSS, can also get you written stuff, blog posts or news or whatever. And I recently downloaded an app on my iPad, not my iPhone, but my iPad. And let me look it up. I forget what it's called, but it's an open source feed reader. And what is it called? Well, that's just embarrassing. Is it in my news folder? Might be. Yeah, that's where it is. It's called NewsNet NewsWire. And believe it or not, there's a whole lot of stuff out there that is that has RSS feeds. Just look for the little RSS logo on websites or even email newsletters. We have a couple of local newsletters, the Traverse Ticker and the Leelanau Ticker. And it's a daily newsletter, you know, just stuff going on in the area. You know, and it's not a political thing, and it's not a, you know, controversial thing most of the time. It just tells you, you know, kind of what's going on in the area. And they have RSS, and the link was right in the, you know, right in the newsletter. I opened up the newsletter, and I saw that RSS link. I said, oh, let's check this out. And then I got to looking at feed readers and found that NetNewsWire. It's pretty darn good. So, you know, you might think of that instead of, you know, going to Facebook or Twitter or X, whatever, to get your news. Or, you know, go, God forbid, the network news sites or the cable news sites. It's a, you know, barren wasteland of garbage. Scare. But, you know, if you find some blog or reasonable news source, oh, get the hiccups, reasonable news source, that you can subscribe to via an RSS feed. Well, there you go. There's your decentralized news, just like, you know, what you're listening to now is decentralized media. You know, I don't do this show as much as I thought I would, but I still keep it alive. So I appreciate you guys for hanging out. But, you know, this will be here. This podcast will be here, or it'll be somewhere that you'll be able to find. Because it's not controlled by Apple. It's not controlled by Facebook. It's not controlled by Spotify. I hate them too. Although I love their music service. I know I'm a bunch of enigmas wrapped in a confused mess. But, you know, Spotify, if they'd just stay in their lane, would have done pretty good. You know, they're a music service. They're not a podcast service. And, you know, they spent $1 billion trying to get into podcasting, and, you know, to some they seem successful, but again, you know, how many people do you personally know that listen to their podcasts on Spotify? Probably not that many. Or maybe you're one of those people that don't have very many people that you know that listen to podcasts at all. But, you know, I just, again, go back to, you know, keeping things free and open. You know, podcasting is still it. You know, if Apple and Spotify and iHeart and, you know, all these big tech companies decide they don't like what I'm talking about and they take me out of their app, well, I'm still here. And if you get a modern podcast app over at podcastapps.com, you can, you know, you'll still get it. RSS will still continue to work. You know, one way or the other, I'll make sure it works. And that's, you know, that's the good thing about it. But, you know, just simplifying as much as possible on your phone is, you know, help you in both of those ways. You know, whether attention span or distraction or waste of time or you know, just, I mean, people are having neck problems these days because they're always staring down at a screen. You know, I remember I used to be able to watch TV and just actually watch TV. Well, now you can't do that because you got 6 minutes of commercials every 10 minutes. Or, you know, maybe not that much, but it seems that way sometime. Even the streamers now are doing that. You know, if like Netflix is even talking about throwing ads in there, right? Unless you pay them extra. So all those shows, and you know, you can't even forward through the ads on the streamers. The only, you know, we have a couple of them. We have Netflix. My wife likes that. We have Apple TV only because I bought this new iPad and we got a month free. I don't know if we're going to continue to use it. I have Amazon Prime mainly for the free shipping. But, you know, there is some Prime Video that is interesting. But I pretty rarely watch any over-the-air TV. And that simplifies it. You know, I have an antenna now. I don't have cable. I have, you know, I have way more stuff to watch on the internet through the Apple TV or in this case, in my office here, I've got a Amazon Fire Stick. But, you know, I can watch all kinds of stuff, even live stuff. You know, there's lots of live feeds that you can listen to or watch. And so there's a lot of stuff to listen to. And, you know, kind of when I was, you know, when I was younger and we didn't have all this internet stuff, I did a lot of shortwave listening. And now a lot of that has all gone to the internet. You know, the BBC World Service, I think, still transmits on a few towers, but for the most part, they're an internet service. The Voice of America, I know for a fact, they got 500 or so shows that formerly were transmitted on shortwave. Now they still transmit on shortwave around the world and all that. But that's what we listened to back in the day, or we would watch, you know, TV. And back then, you know, TV, you went to MTV, that was music television. You go to CMTV, it was country music television. You go to the Discovery Channel and you actually discovered things. You went to History Channel and they talked about history. Imagine that. Or the Weather Channel even now, it's mostly reality shows and all that and very little weather. You know, you get the little scroller around the side of the screen, but that's it for weather. You know, it's not like it used to be. And, you know, everybody's kind of going to the same model, and I'm just tired of it. You know, and, you know, back to the dumb phone versus smartphone thing, it's like, you know, I would love at some point in the future to just have like a light phone or something similar to that or a dumbed down iPhone. You know, the only thing I have to have really on a phone is podcasts. And I could probably get away with not doing that and go back to the old way of putting it on a portable device, an iPod-type device, even though they don't really make an iPod anymore. You know, something like that I'm sure still exists, that if you really wanted to, you could go completely off the grid and do that. I find that I'm watching a lot of off-grid YouTube channels as well. A lot of people are getting into that, and you know, it is interesting how much you can do without a lot of the tech. Now, you know, a lot of them are, you know, obviously I'm watching a YouTube channel, so they're into tech. But you know, this one guy in West Virginia that I've been watching, you know, he's got a solar set up, and of course he's got a portable generator, and he works from home. He has his own business. So, you know, he makes products and sends them out, or has them made and sends them out. So plus he's doing pretty good on YouTube, I understand. So he's got quite the lifestyle where he doesn't have a television necessarily. He's got he does have a TV, but I don't think it's hooked up to anything that would get outside stuff other than internet. And he does have a, you know, Starlink internet. So, you know, he is tech, but it's a much simpler existence. And I don't know if I'm ready quite for that. I don't feel like chopping wood and raising ducks and geese and whatever, raising my own food or whatnot. Probably not a bad idea, but I really can't do it where I am, and I don't feel like moving. So I'm lazy. Come on. If I wasn't lazy, you'd get episode of this podcast more often. Figure that out. Some of the new things we're doing at Blueberry, you'll notice, hopefully if it all works, on my website, the new player there has chapters. And I generate that via an AI thing on Blueberry that we're testing. So I generate those chapter files that way. So there'll be little spots in the player or apps that you, you know, if you get one of those new apps over at podcastapps.com and look for one that does chapters, and you can jump around. Of course, I jump around for you, so you probably don't need it on this show, but you know, you'll notice that a lot of other shows are doing that. Same thing with transcripts. I've been putting transcripts on these here, you know, the last, I don't know, probably a couple of years. And now Apple is even going to start pulling in transcripts or creating one for you if you don't do it yourself. The only problem with that is it's only on Apple. If you do it through through one of these new apps, it's everywhere. And that's, you know, that's a good thing. I don't, you know, a lot of people that are hearing impaired probably don't listen to podcasts or consume podcasts in most ways, but they do now have that option. You could read it. I don't know if I'd want to read this one, but it could be interesting. I don't know if you hear the jet taking off, but away he goes. Remember, I'm close to the airport. So anyway, I guess I've rambled on long enough and jumped subjects 4, 5, 6 times. But yeah, that's why you listen to me. So with that, everybody have a good, however long it is, till the next one. And if you want to hear me on a more regular basis, autohistorypodcast.com. That's the Auto History Podcast in video and audio. And that's with my co-host Mike Wilkerson from the Two Guys Talking Network. And we're committed to doing 2 episodes a month for now. We'll probably kick that up at some point in the future. And, of course, you can hear me on Podcast Insider at least 3 out of 4 weeks a month. We switch up the hosts, so it's I'm usually on 3 of them. Todd's on 3 of them, and Mackenzie is on 3 of them, and however that works out, we're in pairs. But podcastinsider.com, and that one does come out every single week if you're interested in podcasting on the business side or creator side. That's a good one to listen to. And I'll have a few links in the show notes here just to you know, talk about stuff I talked about, the article from BBC, the light phone, and turning your iPhone into a dumb phone. So with that, catch me later.